Hello and welcome to Ásbyrgi, one of the most amazing natural phenomena in Iceland. But what is this thing in the nature? How come it looks like this? So this video is about answers, and if we start with the Norse mythology, it is the hoofprint of Sleipnir, the eight-legged horse of the god Odin. According to legend, Sleipnir stepped down from the heavens and left this massive imprint on the earth. And I recommend that we keep those mythology ideas away from scientists, because Ásbyrgi was in fact carved out during a catastrophic flood several thousand years ago. But the general knowledge about that event is, however, still limited. The most likely explanation is a flood due to a volcanic eruption in Bárðarbunga volcano. Not only is it Iceland's largest volcano, the caldera is situated under Europe's largest glacier, Vatnajökull, and it's no ordinary caldera. It's full of ice, up to 750 meters thick. And if the ice would melt, it would leave us with somewhere around 40,000 gigaliters today. So we have some spectacular numbers to work with when it comes to speculations about the flood that is responsible for all this. And it only adds to the mystery that this giant caldera is getting ready to erupt, as you can see in my most recent volcano updates. And although Bárðarbunga is suspect number one when it comes to the Great Flood, we can't rule out an ice dam on the glacier, since there are in fact seven volcanoes under Vatnajökull glacier in addition to the other high temperature areas that constantly melt the ice. So the glacier alone, without any volcanic activity at all, is capable of releasing vast amounts of meltwater. But it's not easy to find the evidence, especially when it comes to a long gone ancient glacier lagoons. And to further increase the mystery about the origin of Ásbyrgi, it is believed that this is the result of two or even three floods, depending on what sources I refer to, and the timing of those events is also a mystery. The oldest flood is generally thought to have occurred 8 to 10,000 years ago, and the youngest flood could be even around 2,000 years old. And again, this all depends on what sources I use. But according to the most official source, the visitor center by Ásbyrgi, the peak discharge was estimated to be 900,000 cubic meters per second. That makes this one of the largest known floods on Earth, and evidence can be found all along the river's course all the way up to the central highlands. Like the road up to the glacier, it runs through this huge floodplain where the river managed to spread out and form the largest body of water in Iceland for a while. And as we follow the river, the drama begins, where it carved out the dramatic Jökulsárgljúfur Canyon and formed landmarks like Dettifoss, one of Europe's most powerful waterfalls. And although it looks impressive as we know it today, with the average flow of 200 cubic meters per second, that just isn't very much when we upgrade this to 900,000. And first then can we start to imagine what went down there, or when we try to sense the scale of the flood, especially when we see how small the waterfall becomes in the obvious flood path around it from the Megaflood. And further downstream, the canyon is up to 1 kilometer wide and up to 100 meters deep, and the flood actually exposed many geological features in the landscape, features that we would not like to be without today, like this formation, Hljóðaklettar, where the river exposed ancient basalt columns, while it carved out numerous caves. So this location deserves its own video that I will make soon. And after the flood rushed through Hljóðaklettar, it bypassed its old path and went straight to business with Ásbyrgi, where it obviously found a weak spot and made its way through numerous lava layers and exposed this cross-section on one of the largest sealed volcano in Iceland, Þeistareykjabunga. And I actually made a video about that volcano recently, so I'm linking to it, since we are likely looking at many of the same lava layers as we saw up there. And if I would place that if was a waterfall here, it would look very tiny when we look at the big picture. And it is noticeable that the flood left not one single boulder in the canyon. All the material got washed away out to the bay, never to be seen again. So what we had were enormous forces at work. But the flood hit an obstacle that split it for some reason, and this is that obstacle, this massive structure that is often called the island, but I often prefer to call it the ship, and the reason is obvious. And we can see that the ship has this gentle slope, so it's no problem to walk up there. It was the National Forest Service that purchased Ásbyrgi in 1927 in order to protect an old birch forest, and they started a new forestry project from that, a project that turned out just fine, and the autumn colors, they are revealing some experiments with different species, but to protect the native birds, that was the original idea. And in 1974, Ásbyrgi became a part of a national park that was established to protect the canyons, and that park would later become a part of the Vatnajökull National Park, and today this national park covers the complete Vatnajökull glacier, so it's the largest national park in Iceland. And it's actually quite rare to see so successful forestry project this far north in Iceland. But it helps that Ásbyrgi provides natural shelter. So during summer, we often see very high temperature numbers here. And that made this campsite very popular amongst Icelanders early on. And it still is, although foreign tourists have of course discovered this location as well. And the National Park has an information and visitor center by the mouth of the canyon. It's a worthy visit for the information value, but I like the local store even more. It is situated just outside the canyon by the highway. It's mostly a farmer's convenience store during winter, but of course a popular tourist stopover during summer. And it's a special breed of country store, the type we don't see anymore. You can get all the basic household necessities, but the display is very unconventional. So I love that store. And I love the fact that I can get bacon and eggs there, and not just a typical fast food by the highway. And this isn't even by highway number one, but it should be, because highway number one is just an old concept that wasn't supposed to be this guideline for tourists. It leaves out remarkable places like this, which is a real shame, because behind this geological phenomena is a story that begins above the mantle plume and reflects the geological uniqueness of Iceland. So it's not just the nature that is so unique, it's the history about the roots of our country. And this place, Ásbyrgi, has since childhood given me the opportunity to wonder about its origin. My family used to stay around here for around 2 weeks every summer, and we would sometimes walk to the end of the trail to the little pond, and that was before mass tourism, so we could test out the echo there with all sorts of tricks that would get us expelled today. And still today, I love to stop by. This place is always inspiring me. So my plan is to keep on filming around the river, all the way up to Bárðarbunga volcano, and the drone won't be enough for that, which is one of the reasons for my camera upgrade, or to give me the chance to film from a plane in a decent quality. But more about that later. As usual, I'm leaving links in the video description to nearby attractions. That list will change over time, of course, since this is a huge task to cover all the hotspots here in Iceland. So feel free to subscribe for what is to come. And with that, I'm sending you best regards from the volcano island, Iceland.